Hi everybody, this is Dr. A with an anatomy and physiology review of the integumentary system, or the skin, hair, and nails. All right, as a quick overview, the function of the integumentary system, or the skin, is a two-way protective barrier, temperature regulation. It houses the sensory receptors and it secretes important fluids. Now I'm going to break all this down for you guys here in just a minute. The organs of the integumentary system that allow this function to happen are the skin, the hair, the nails, the sebaceous glands, and sweat glands. So the skin is the largest organ in the body, weighing more than 20 pounds. Kind of freaky to think about like the skin being off of us, but if it were and you were to weigh it, it would weigh 20 pounds for the average person, obviously. The primary function of the skin is protection. I like to think or to say that it keeps the inside in and the outside out, right? So it forms a two-way barrier that keeps pathogens and harmful substances out and keeps critical body fluids in. The skin also protects the internal organs and the tissues. The sensory receptors are housed in the middle layer of the skin, which we're going to learn is called the dermis, and they detect a number of sensations such as temperature, pain, touch, pressure, etc. And messages from those receptors then travel down the nerves to the brain and spinal cord. It actually goes first to the spinal cord and then to the brain. And then the brain would interpret those signals and react to them in one way or another. The sweat glands produce sweat. The role of sweat is to evaporate off the skin and create a cooling effect. So this is really very relevant during the summertime when it's really hot outside. The sebaceous glands produce an oil called sebum. The sebum lubricates the skin and keeps it from becoming too dry. This is why oil can actually be really good for your skin. And you can use skincare or create your own skin products and stuff with that are oil-based. You do want an oil that doesn't clog up your pores, of course. To cool skin, sweat evaporates, and then also superficial blood vessels will dilate to release the heat through the skin. So they'll pop up closer, like if your hands are nice and warm, a lot of times your superficial veins on top of your hand will really pop and you can really see them. Now to conserve heat, let's say your hands are really cold, these superficial blood vessels will constrict and prevent heat from escaping through the skin. And so if your hands are cold, you may not even hardly be able to see your veins because they're all just down into the deeper layers. And the subcutaneous layer will serve as insulation to keep us warm, especially in the winter. The skin consists of two layers, the epidermis, which is a thin outer membrane layer, and then the dermis, which is the middle fibrous connective tissue layer. It's thicker. The subcutaneous layer is also important, and it's underneath the dermis, and it's a layer of fatty tissue that's below the skin. The epidermis is composed of stratified squamous epithelium, and these are flat scale-like cells. They are arranged in overlapping layers called strata, so layers strata. And the epidermis has no blood supply or connective tissue. All of that is in the dermis. So here is a representation of cross-section of skin. So if we start at the top, we have here the epidermis, and we can see different strata already here. We are going to look at that a little bit more here in just a second. We see hair, we see a sweat pore, but then if you go below that, we have this nice thick layer here, that's the dermis. In which we see the capillary blood supply, we see the nerves and sensory receptors here, we see the hair follicle and the erector pili muscle and sebaceous gland, and you know the sweat glands are going through there, and then of course underneath the dermis is here this subcutaneous layer of fat. So just to give you an illustration, do notice here that your capillary blood supply is in the dermis and not the epidermis. And so if you get a paper cut and it bleeds, I mean, you've cut at least into the dermis, right? So let's talk about the epidermis. The basal layer of the epidermis is the deepest layer of the epidermis. It is the layer that would be right on top of the dermis, right? And in this layer, the cell will continuously grow and they push the old cells towards the surface. And during this process, those cells that are being pushed up, they'll shrink, they'll die, and they'll fill with keratin. And then you're always just shedding some throughout your day, throughout life, as you go about your daily life. And the reason the basal layer is the one that grows is the one that's the closest to the blood supply that is found in the dermis. The more the cells are pushed up, the less they have access to the oxygen and nutrients that are coming from the dermis, and so that's why they die. The keratinized cells will overlap and allow the skin to act as a waterproof barrier. So keratin is a type of protein that is made by these cells. The basal cell layer also contains melanocytes. The melanocytes produce the black pigment melanin that gives skin its color. And the role of melanin is to protect skin against ultraviolet rays of the sun. So melanin is what gives you your tan in the summer. So the more you are exposed to the sun, the darker your skin tone will become. But how light and how dark you are is genetically determined by how much melanin you produce kind of at baseline, and then, you know, depending on your exposure to UV ray. An interesting fact is that we all have the same amount of melanocytes. We just produce different amounts of melanin, which is what gives the variation in skin colors. Next is the dermis. So the dermis or corium is the deeper layer of skin. It's located between the epidermis and the subcutaneous layer. It is a living tissue with a good blood supply. The capillary bed is all throughout that dermis. It is made of connective tissue and collagen fibers, and that gives skin its strength and its elasticity. So the fact that you can pinch your skin and stuff and it bounces back. And as your skin ages, you lose some of that. You lose some of the elastin, you lose some of the collagen, and it becomes more paper-like. Sorry. The ridges formed in the dermis creates unique fingerprints. So the fingerprints, it's not just the epidermis, it's the variations all the way down into the dermis. And there are a number of structures that are housed in the dermis, such as the hair follicles, the sweat and sebaceous glands, the blood vessels, the lymph vessels, your sensory receptors and nerve fibers, and even some muscle fibers that are attached to the hair. And then at the bottom in between this dermis and the rest of the connective tissue in the body, you have the subcutaneous layer, also known as a hypodermis, meaning below the dermis. It lies beneath the skin, and it is made mostly of fat cells called lymphocytes, and it protects the deeper tissues of the body and acts as an insulation against the heat and cold. Hair is an accessory organ. It consists of the follicle, the hair root, the shaft, and the erector pili muscle. The erector pili muscle will contract to make the hair shaft stand up and give you goosebumps. As hair grows older, just like with the epidermis of the skin, the keratinized cells are forced upward by the new cells in the hair follicle that are being made, and that makes your hair grow longer and longer and longer. Now, melanin also gives hair its color, which I think is interesting. There are two types of melanin that give hair its color. You have the eumelanin, so EU melanin, meaning true melanin, and then you have pheomelanin. So this is how it works. If you have a lot of eumelanin, your hair is going to be black. If you have a little bit less eumelanin, then your hair is going to be brown. If you have the lowest amount of eumelanin, then your hair is going to be blonde. And then if you have some pheomelanin in there, you're going to have a red tinge to it. So if you have, for example, very little eumelanin and some pheomelanin, you'd have a strawberry blonde color. But if you have more eumelanin and some pheomelanin, you may have an auburn color. So there you go. That kind of explains that. And then we're going to move on here to a picture showing Again, the cross section. So we have this subcutaneous layer. You see here the hair root where all the new hair cells are being produced. This is where the blood supply is. So new cells are being produced there. And then as they're being made, they're being pushed up and the hair gets longer and longer. Attached to the side of the hair are the sebaceous glands. And so they produce the oily sebum. And so the oily sebum actually makes your hair softer. And it also makes your skin softer and is not dry and cracked, and etc. And then you have here this erector pili muscle. If it contracts, your hair stands on end. It can contract if you're cold. It can contract if you're scared. You can get goosebumps from reaction to music. It's kind of cool, but that's what makes your hair stand on end. Next are the nails. So the main part of the nail is the flat plate of keratin. It's called the nail body. So nail body right there, right? And then the nail body is connected to the underlying tissue by the nail bed. Can't see it, it's just underneath, right? And lunula is at the base of the nail. So think of, it's like a little moon shape, and sometimes it shows up and sometimes it doesn't. So for example, in the tip of my nails here, you can't see it, but for my thumb, you can kind of see it. It's kind of hard to tell, but I have a little bitty white lunula for my thumbs, but not on my other fingers. So it's lunar moon shape lunula. That's what that little shape is, and you may or may not see it on your nail. The nail grows from the nail root, which is covered by the cuticle, and it's the same principle where the keratinized cells, is a lot more keratin because it's harder, grow, and as it grows, it pushes the nail outward, and then you get the free edge that is exposed, and that's the part that must be trimmed. And then the next accessory organ is going to be the sebaceous glands. So they release sebum directly into hair follicles. That sebum lubricates the hair and the skin and prevents drying and cracking. The sebaceous secretions will increase during adolescence, leading to acne, and that has to do with some of the hormonal changes that happen during acne. And those secretions then decrease with age, which can contribute to wrinkles and dry skin. Last accessory organ is the sweat glands. So the sweat glands, or sudoriferous glands, are coil glands in the dermis. The sweat travels to the surface via a sweat duct, and it exits to the surface via a sweat pore. Sweat cools the body as it evaporates. Most sweat is colorless and odorless, but sweat from the apocrine glands produce body odor. And your apocrine glands, for example, are, you know, in your armpits. For, and so that's why if you are like stressed, where all the places where you stress sweat is where your apocrine glands are, and those tend to develop during the teenage years, which is when all of a sudden we discover the use of deodorant. So there you go. This is the end of your review on the anatomy and physiology of the integumentary system. Thanks for tuning in.